We are thrilled to have artist Elinor Hartt here today to talk about her pen and ink drawings being shown in the GCC gallery. Elinor's drawings are included in the collection of the Fogg Museum at Harvard University, the Hirshhorn Museum in Washington, D.C., the Minnesota Museum of Art, and the National Gallery of Art in Washington, D.C. We are very lucky to display Elinor's drawings in the GCC South Gallery, and even more so that she has agreed to give a gallery talk about her work and career as an artist. So without further ado, let's listen to this inspiring woman's story.
Much. Oh, me. Well, I am not a speech maker, and I do not wish to begin here. But I would like to just say that I'm very glad to be here among artists. I feel real resonation. No, that's not the word. Anyway, I do resonate to all of you who are wanting to be artists or who have already become so, and say that there was never a time in my life when I wanted to be anything but an artist. And that has partly to do with my father having been an artist. And I will start with a word about him. He came from no other artist in the family. He just was there suddenly. And he heard about different places he wanted to go. And so he went, and there he was, being an artist. And he was doing various things, but they all had to do with his passion for design. And that was what really attracted him. Somehow he got into lighting fixture designing, and he was asked at one point late in his career, "Now, what have you done?" "Well, I have designed and manufactured the highest and the biggest. The highest on top of the Empire State, and the biggest in Radio City." And then he would sort of chuckle because they didn't have anything to do with precious design. But he kept on working, and he had a wife who was a musician. My mother was a concert pianist, and two brothers were different studies, but what they both got into was violin and cello. So I had wonderful trios at night when I went to bed. I heard good music. And I think that rubbed off somehow on what I was doing. And I kept on doing my scribbling, and my father scribbled all the time. And I noticed that he signed his name, initials, E-H-N. And I thought, that's very convenient. They're my initials too. So mine were E-H-N Junior. And I didn't see anything amusing about that, but that it was. And I think it was his influence that I didn't have to go to college. I didn't want to go to college. I was ready to go to college, but I didn't want to. I wanted to go to art school. My mother and brothers thought it might be nice for me to go to college, because then when I married, I'd have something to talk to my husband about. I'd be educated. But I resisted that. And my father said, "Well, it's fine with me because art school doesn't cost as much as college." So I went to New York and found the Art Students League and found somebody to study with through somebody that I knew. And this person was of no announcement to himself at all. But he gave me a good, sturdy beginning, and in oils mainly, in tempera. But then I worked, and the Art Students League, I think, is much the same today as it was, that many accomplished artists go back there to study with a certain artist that's well known. Is that true? I guess. And so I studied there, and I learned quite a bit about painting, but I was always doing these little sketchy things. And at one point I brought in a sketch to my teacher, and he looked at it and he said, "That's your medium." And that was the greatest influence on me, because I had thought of it as sort of a beginning to something else. And now I heard that it was a medium unto itself. And so I kept on working at it. And I remember my father just saw the beginning of my pen and ink. I'm sorry he didn't live longer. But he said, "She knows what to do with that pen." And oh, I was so pleased with that. So I never really, once I'd got into pen and ink, I never wanted to do something else and would have had to educate myself all over again. But my advice is, certainly if anybody here wants to do this kind of thing or something a little different, give yourself a good chance of doing it. And just keep on working at it until you find whether you really are in love with the medium or whether it's just a passing fancy. And I was in love with this stuff, as you can tell. So I went on and on doing this, and went to New York, and oh, I heard that there was a show in which I put something, and the judge put it in the show, and her name was Betty Parsons. And that rang a bell for me, because she was an art person in New York, had a gallery. And so I thought, well, if she liked something I did enough to put it in a show, I'll start with her. And I went into Parsons' gallery with a couple of drawings, and the man who was there working with her said, "Betty will be in a minute. Oh, Betty, come here, look at this work." And she came, and she said, "Oh, like hundreds of birds in Africa rising up." And she looked more, and she said, "I want you in the gallery. Think it over." And I said, "Thank you, Betty. I have thought it over. I want to be here." So I went no further, and I stayed with her. She was well along in years already then, so I stayed with her until she finished and went to another sort of gallery, but not hard work. And I don't know, from then on I worked and worked until I found it interesting to start with looking at some museum possibilities, and was taken by the museums that you've heard about in the introduction, and very glad to be taken. So I was just awfully sorry that my father didn't live to see more of my work, because he was my greatest influence. But he was an influence not in this medium. He never did that. But he was an influence in doing something that he had to do and persevering with it and really loving it. Because I doubt that you can do any medium for any length of time unless you love doing it. You may fight with yourself a few times about it, but I think you have to really love what you're up to. And I did. And I think that there's not much more to say. I would like very much to hear your questions and to know where you are in your art development. Open to question?
Well, I know a little bit, so I'd like to hear more about your experiences in Macchiato and Taos.
Oh, yes. Well, I did ask to go to some gallery, what do you call it?
Residency?
Yeah, residences. And I would apply with something. And the application had to be with something like a little pad on a pencil, on a paper. And it looked like, it was sort of magic marker looking. And if you can imagine some of this work done by magic markers, you're not impressed. And so I thought, well, it wouldn't do much good, but it always got me somewhere. And I did go to Yaddo, and Yaddo was a wonderful place to be with other, not only visual artists, but musicians and writers. And we all got together at a table for meals if we wanted to. It was all if you want to. If you don't want to do any of this, you're welcome to stay by yourself. Nobody is allowed to go and just knock and come in your door and see your work. They have to have some prelude. And in Yaddo, I met other interesting artists. I can't remember particularly the whom of it, but I know that I really was engaged by this kind of sharing of different media and felt myself lucky to have got chosen on that basis. So what else about me? I think that's enough about me. Well, I'm so glad to see everybody here, some of whom are known to me. And I do want to hear, about students particularly, where they are in their work and what they are hoping to do and what frustrates you and what pleases you. Some of the ideas.
Yeah, how long did it take you to complete one?
How long?
Oh, how long? You know, that is a question that I find very difficult to answer because I never sit down and do one of those big things all at once. Right. It's several engagements. And I go away and think about it and always come back to it until it's finished to my satisfaction. And at Yaddo, when I didn't have anything else to do at all, I may have taken 3 weeks to work hard on one. But I think that's about it.
I have a question, Eleanor.
Yes.
Hi. Do you have an idea in mind when you start, or does the idea emerge as you work?
Well, thank you. I mainly usually have some idea in my mind. And I start, sometimes it's an idea that begins at the top and goes down. The idea and the drawing go this way together. And if I feel like it, I take a pencil and make a very, very light marks of the definitions of the space. And maybe an idea for the movement of the space. But that would all be pencil and very slight. And then I would start working at the top generally. And most always, unless I have a specific idea of a darkness at the top, I would start with a lightness, which can then be developed. And I would go back from it, and it would tell me something. And it's true that the drawing tells you what it has to do. And that's why I say, when you look at these pictures, please listen very carefully, because they tell you something about themselves, too. I think you have a, have you got a question, sir? No? Yes.
Did you keep a sketchbook of ideas, or did you keep a journal or a sketchbook or anything from which you then took ideas, or did you work?
No.
You never did?
I didn't. I just looked at the picture periodically, and it kept saying things to me. This is a good idea, or that is a good idea. And if I'm working lightly, it develops. If I go very dark and think, I wish I hadn't done that, there's nothing I can do about it.
Okay.
that becomes the darkness. I've had only one friend who has worked similarly to this, but with a pencil. He was a young man, and he was at Betty Parsons' gallery. And he said, "How do you do it with ink? You make a mistake." I said, "I make a mistake in the light part, and I yell." And I said, "How do you do it with pencil?" "Goodness, you do it with pencil, and you make a mistake, and you smudge. What do you do?" He said, "Can't help." Anyway, that it makes it two different media, really, pencil and pen, I think. And I don't know other people at this point who are working in this medium, actually, because I don't travel around so much anymore in art circles. And if there's somebody here who has seen something kindred to this and wants to tell me where it is, I'd like to know. Nobody? Good.
Hello. Hi, Ellen.
Hello.
Maybe paintings are supposed to be like children. You're not supposed to have a favorite. But I'm wondering, is there a particular work that you've done that just captures your soul or energy?
Me?
Something that you've done.
My things captures me?
Yeah.
Just about every one of them has captured me as I've done it. Am I able to move? Yes. Yes, I am. But I will say one thing, that this drawing here is the latest one I did. And it's different from the others in that it really has pen strokes going in all directions if you look at it in the right light. And speaking of the right light, I was afraid that it was going to be so full of, light and things that it would spoil it, but it doesn't. And I really like it quite a lot, I'm glad to say. That's the kind of picture that more people than any have said, well, what is it supposed to be? And that seems to be a very important thing to most people. It has to be something. And I have sold more color than I have black and white because some people think that they're not getting their money's worth with black and white. It's true. And at one point in my early development, I was known as the Moon Lady because of, you can see these two, and I've done many other moons in different stages of their development. Yes.
I've just looked at the work very briefly today, and I haven't taken the time to listen to them. But I wonder if you would say something about this dark one here in the corner.
Oh yes, the dark one, very dark, and yet there is it. What's making it? Do you hear a noise back there? Well, I'll come up a little further. The black one is about the darkest I could get and still have something happening in it, but you have to study it for a while to see the happenings. And the one next to it is an inkless intaglio, which is done, as you probably know, with paper clamped down. And I did that, and I did it particularly because students liked it a lot. And speaking of students, I have taught various ages of students, but I feel always that you don't teach art. You simply listen to the student who wants to do something and learn something, and then you help open his or her eyes to what this person sees. Too many people, children, are badly taught. I had one art class in New York, and I did teach there for a while. A child came in and stood firmly before me and said, "I hate modern art." And I said, "Oh, that's interesting. What is modern art?" "Mess, simply mess." And I said, "Okay, well, sit down, we'll have some fun with it." And the person sat down, and I did critiques around. I came to his work, and it was quite beautiful, really drawing of excitement. And I gave him my opinion of it. He immediately tore it up. And his father came in later and was looking at another picture with him and said, "Now this boat is behind this boat, isn't it, sir? Isn't it, child?" And he said, "Yes." "Well, then it must be smaller, mustn't it?" And told him exactly what must happen in the picture, and simply took all the fun and all the excitement and the experimentation out of it. And I felt very sad for that.
Have you always been interested in making art?
In making art?
Yes.
Always. Always. And I always would look at something and want to do a picture of it. And my father was so helpful because he was so excited about seeing what I was doing. And at the same time, he was critical. But his criticism was careful not to, you know, tread on what was making me do it. And so I was grateful to him.
And to follow up that question, what are your earliest memories as a small child of art that you did?
Well, as a small child, I think his work was probably my earliest memory, because he wanted to draw whatever he saw and experiment with it. And it's amazing because even when he became a major artist in the art world, as far as his big drawing, his high drawing, but he never stopped being interested in experimentation and what could happen. And that gave me the idea, I can too, by gum.
And how did you start, though? As a child, what did you do? What did you actually do then, as you, you know, reflected on his art?
Well, I'm not sure, but I had some classes of little children who wanted to learn and knew that I had done something. So they came, and I would simply give them paper and a wide magic marker, probably, something that they could experiment with. And I would, if they wanted an idea, I'd give it to them. But mainly, I would say, do what you feel like doing. And it would work, I'm happy to say. Well,
question. What kind of ink did you use besides India ink? Like with the colors?
Color ink was also related to color. I mean, related to India ink, but color. Uh-huh. Nothing very, very exotic. Because I tried a couple of things and didn't find any difference in the more expensive inks.
And have you found them color fast?
Mm-hmm, pretty much. Now something, there's a little one there that's very delicate, of a little moon rising. Yeah, up there in the corner. And that if exposed to sunlight, that would probably begin to be wounded. But otherwise, I haven't found much harm in light.
Along the same lines, what kind of a pen would you use? Did you use a very, pointed, just a simple pen?
Yeah.
Or did you use a technical pen?
No, no technical things. You go into an art store and you see pen holders with little pen points. And there's a variety. And what I used most of all was the finest, the most, finest. And then I would always have a couple of more bigger writers that if I wanted to make a little bit, I could use, but it was scarce.
I think that's amazing because I know those are so hard to control, the ink flow. So
it's hard to control?
The ink flow.
Oh, yes. Well, you have a scratch pad and you dry it out before you go, but it has to be something that is, that works the way you want it to do, and you can tell very soon if it doesn't work. Did I ever what?
Did you ever change the orientation from horizontal to vertical once you were midway through, or decide how to hang something different than your original thought when you were into it?
From one measurement to the other?
Right, like a couple are horizontal.
Yeah. Okay,
and the two down there are more vertical. And I'm wondering if you designed them that way?
Yes, yeah. Pretty much, yeah. I have a couple who aren't here that were definitely vertical and could never be anything else because they became very dark. I did quite a lot in Taos with the mountains and it was wonderful working there.
I can see how the music gets involved.
You what?
I can tell how the music, because you said you listen to a lot of good music, sort of when you
talk.
I can see how it affects, how you get your emotion and your feelings going into them.
I'm glad because the music I grew up with, I was so fortunate in having good music. I mean, if you want to talk about classical music, it was very good. I also love good jazz, and I think both had an influence, but the good jazz, I don't have anything here that's very jazzy, but I did do a few things that were quick and jazzy. But do you feel a musical influence?
Yeah, well, music itself can put you in the mode or into the feel, especially when you're sitting down, you don't really have much to go with.
Yes.
You just got a blank piece of paper, and then you put on some music, and it kind of starts to get your emotions going to get to where you want to be.
Oh, definitely. I think that's quite right. And well, yes, music, and sometimes I would say, well, I need another influence, and I would stop for a little while and take a walk. And see trees or water or something that would find its way into me and then come out as a drawing. And it's important, I think, if you're working with children, to let them realize that whatever they look at, there's something to see, because too many people don't see anything. I knew a person once who was invited to come into our living room where there were lots of drawings, and he came in and I thought he would be quite susceptible. He came in, he looked around and he said, "Nice pair of end tables you have here." And some people look very, very hard, it seems, that they don't really see anything. And I think it's because if you really see something, it makes a deep impression upon you, and you can't just run away. It's in you, and it's going to influence you some way if it's real, and you're scared of it.
Did you feel like it was challenging being a woman in the art world at any point in your life?
I didn't feel that, strangely enough. I mean, I think when I was in it, I was just there, and it was the art, and it was me, but I didn't feel any difficulty because I was a woman or any exclusiveness. Maybe I would today, because it's more open, more talked about now, but that's true. And I can't say anything about how different my work would be had I been a man. I suppose different, it had to be different in some way, but I don't know how. I don't think are these very feminine drawings? I don't know.
No.
They're not.
I think to get the feeling, to get in the drawing, when you look at them, is what's more important than who did it.
Yeah.
Because it's what you get out of the painting or drawing or picture, is what you want to feel, is what the main thing.
Yeah.
Because otherwise, you wouldn't have that picture in your living room or have it, you know, on your wall or something.
Yeah.
Unless it had the purpose or meaning.
Well, I'm awfully glad that I persevered with this one, which is the last one I did, because I knew the kind of feeling I wanted it to express. And it took quite a long while of working at it from different angles. And I myself was surprised when it was done to walk over to one particular corner where there was no reflections at all, and to look at it and to see how many directions the lines went in, and which were major directions and which were just amplifications of the main ones. But I wanted it to be all one, and I wanted people to say, what does this have to be? Because it doesn't have to be anything.
Do you name your paintings?
Sometimes in early days we did name them. Then later they didn't want names, and so if there are names on these, they're on the back of them. I didn't have a lot of time to work on this to see what the names were, what the whether some of them are NFS, not for sale, and some of them are for sale and should have a price on, which the prices were established rather long ago by Betty Parsons in New York and Barbara Fiedler in Washington and other teachers. So I don't know price wise. You have much better idea than I do.
Is the latest one named?
Pardon?
Is your latest picture named? Have you named that one?
Latest one? No, I haven't.
Do you sometimes name them much later on? Will it ever have a name, perhaps?
Yes, sometimes I have done that.
And so that's your last one that you created. What do you do now, or do you sketch?
What would I do now?
What do you do now for creativity to get your thoughts down?
Well, you know, I've thought about it. I can't do anything because my eyes are no longer functioning. The eye hand doesn't work anymore, sorry to say. But when I look at something, I still see something essential in it. I mean, it can be very sturdy, like that black and brown one.
What you do is listen.
What I do, yes.
You do is listen.
I listen, and when I look, I see, I hope. So many people look all the time and really don't see much of anything. Sorry to say.
What you do now is write poetry.
What?
You write poetry.
Yes, I admit to that. I've never written a poem that I didn't have to. But my name, I was christened Elinor Higby Nostrand, and I introduced myself very early as Elnie Biggadaby Notney, because that worked in the sound, you know? And I love really good poetry, seems to me, to go with the visual. They're very closely related. Anybody here think about poems? Not immediately, you do.
I think poems give you a central inlet of what to visualize, because some poems really tell a story or bring an image to you that can really help focus on something that you can draw.
That's true. And just the sound of poems, when the sound is wonderful together, gives you an idea of visually something that's working together. And music, of course. Well, the arts are, heaven knows, well related. Any further questions? Sir?
Would you say that landscape and nature are your main source of inspiration?
Which in nature?
Would you say that nature is your main source of inspiration for your drawing?
Sometimes, yes. But not copying nature, but just relating to the feeling that nature gives you. It is quite a different thing.
You had said that that people called you the Moon Lady.
They what?
That people had called you the Moon Lady.
Oh yes.
Are those like when people need to put names and ideas behind your drawings? Are those things something you can disregard, or do they end up influencing you?
Oh, I think they probably have some influence, and I have been influenced by the moon since I was a child. When I was a little, well, toddler, I was with my mother first, and I would cry about something, and she would get me up. She would say, "Are you thirsty? Are you hungry? Do you have to go to the potty?" So forth and so on. I would say, "No, no, no." Whereas my father didn't ask me anything. He picked me up. He put me in his arms in a blanket, and we looked at the moon. And that was very, very important to me. Those two different approaches. Thank you.
I think Elinor will be here for a little while longer if you're too shy to ask, but otherwise,
yes.
Thank you so much for coming today.